Now, I've got a phone here, and it's got sat-nav on it. And Wendy and I went to London the other day, a part of London I wasn't too familiar with, and the sat-nav was great. But on the way back, it cut off. Rubbish. Absolutely rubbish. So I'm driving along in London, and Wendy's saying, you turn left there. He goes, no, look, it's saying go over there. No, you turn left there. No, you go over there. We had a bit of a disagreement in the car. Wendy, it's not about... I'm talking about humility here, aren't I? All right? Okay.
This is GBC Web TV, on the internet at gbcweb.tv. Welcome to Greenford Baptist Church in West London. Here you can watch inspired biblical teaching and find out how to apply God's Word to your everyday lives. On the website, you can also listen to audio versions of these programs or download them as podcasts.
In today's present climate, not the weather climate, even though it's pretty iffy out there at the moment in time, you don't know what you're getting, whether it's going to be wet or whether it's going to be sun, whether it's going to be wet or whether it's going to be sun, but today it's a bit of a bit in between. But in terms of the economical climate, we are living in a certain time where, to me, people security have been taken away from them. Their fortresses, which they thought were sort of had no way of being broken down, have been broken down, and they have no security which they had before. And but we have something in Jesus, which Psalm 18 talks about, as God being a reliable fortress, that in life we can rely on God in every aspect of life. He is there, he will be there always, and he will never fall down. And we need to introduce people to this person because we have something in God which is available to people all around us. And last week, Pastor David spoke about all the different aspects, well, part of what we're doing at the moment in church, and looking at all the outreach we're doing in terms of the community around us. And to me, the biggest part of outreach is not the projects we do together, which is important and brilliant, but it's your individual mission of where God has laid you and put you and placed you. Because each of you have been placed in a unique place. And we are facing a new season. It's September, and September is when lots of new things start in church. In the next 3 weeks, we've got Alpha starting. We've got a money call starting. We have the international evening this weekend. And there's other things in the pipeline starting off. But also, we've already seen there's people who are starting new jobs. There's people who are starting new schools. There are people who are starting new universities. You've all been placed in strategic places, not by man, I believe by God. You've been placed there to be his mouthpiece, to be his hands, to be his feet, to be his body, wherever you are. And it's your place of work, your home you're in, the places you're at, which is so important in terms of what you're portraying to those people, because you've been placed there. You've been placed there. And we can talk about all the great things going on in church life, but to me, the greatest thing in church life is the individual members of this body out in the community, out in the workplace, out in the schools, out in the playgrounds talking to parents, being children of God. Amen. I also want to share a piece of scripture with you. This is going to work. There we go. This is from The Message, and it says this. Watch what God does, and then you do it, like children who learn proper behaviour from their parents. Mostly what God does is love you. Keep company with him and learn a life of love. Observe how Christ loved us. His love was not cautious, but extravagant. He didn't love in order to get something from us, but to give everything of himself to us. Love like that. And I won't say quite simply, because it's not quite simple, is it? It's very hard. It's difficult. It's against the flow of who we are as beings. But God has asked us to love like that. And love like that is what attracts people to God. In Matthew 5, 1 to 11, if you turn to that, it's page 968 in the Church Bible, one of these. 968. And it says this, verses 3 to 10 I'm going to read. We'll start from the top, actually. Now, when he saw the crowds, he went up to a mountainside and sat down. The disciples came down to him, and he began to teach them, saying, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will be shown mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called sons of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven." Now, right in the midst of that, in verse 5, it says, "Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth." Now, this is the question I'm going to ask you, and hopefully you'll put your hand up and answer that. When I say the word meek, what comes up into your mind? Bossy.
Gentleness.
Gentleness. Humble. Sorry? Low in spirit. Being calm. Now, the word humble, are you going to say something?
Simple and down to earth.
Simple and down to earth. The word meek, do you think that's a word of strength, a word of authority, a word of power? Yes?
It doesn't sound like it, but it is.
Okay. But in the world we live in, what is that expressed as? A very weak word. And what God's asked us to be is to be meek. Is to be meek. And if you look in the dictionary, it is described as being humble. And it also is described as a characteristic as humility. If you turn to Philippians, chapter 2, 1 to 11, it's page 1179 in the Church Bible. And it says this. If you have any encouragement from being united with Christ, if any comfort from his love, if any fellowship with the Spirit, if any tenderness and compassion, then make my joy complete. by being like-minded, having the same love, being one in spirit and purpose. Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit, but in humility consider others better than yourselves. Each of you should look not onto only to your own interests, but also to the interests of others. Your attitude should be the same as that of Christ Jesus, who, being in the very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be grasped, but made himself nothing, taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness, and being found in appearance as a man. He humbled himself and became obedient to death, even death on a cross. Therefore God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Amen. Now, verses 1 and 2, it talks about unity and harmony. And one of the areas the Philippians church was having difficulty was in this area. And that's Paul who's written this. But this is something key in any church. For a church to develop and for a church to grow, there needs to be unity and harmony and love towards one another as well. If there isn't any of this, there is problems. Now, recently at the Belgium Grand Prix, I'm not talking about football today, I'm talking about motor racing, Lewis Hamilton was ahead by about 3 seconds. He went into the pits for his tyre change and fuel fill-up, and the team didn't have the tyres ready. So he lost 6 seconds in the pits. It lost him that race. He would have come first. He came second. He was only 2 seconds behind the person who won the race. But because of bad communication in that team, because there was not unity in that team, and there was no harmony in that team, for that moment of time, he didn't achieve what he could have achieved. Earlier on last month, Joan would like this, there was another competition, the Ashes. And during that period of time, the England team, the England squad, came together and won the Ashes. But to achieve that, they needed to work as a team. They needed to have the right people in that team during that period of time. They won it, but they had to work in unity. They had to work together to reach that achievement. The opposition wasn't that bad, wasn't that good that day anyway, but that's another thing. But we won it anyway. But unity makes a big difference in terms of achievement and working together. And for us, as a body, we need unity, we need harmony. Because look back at the church now. We are right to the back, virtually, on a Sunday morning. Because God is adding to our numbers. And, you know, I believe we are living in a time where there is a spiritual battle going on. There is something going on in the background which we cannot see. There is warfare going on which we cannot see. And the enemy will do anything he can to make us stumble, to make us lose focus through relationship difficulties, through just circumstances in life, that we are distracted and we're not working to our full potential. So we need to be sure that we're living as one together, as a body. Verses 3 and 4 goes on, and it comes back to what I started off talking about. And this, to me, is key to us as a body of people and as individuals out in the workplace, out in the world around us. Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit, but in humility, consider others better than yourselves. Each of you should look not at your own interests, but also to the interests of others. And in Galatians, there is two lists in Galatians chapter 5. It says this list here represents the ungodly nature, the sinful nature. And this list represents the fruits of the Spirit, God's way of living. And one list, God's way of living, says love, joy, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. That's how God expects us to live. The other list says these things, which is totally the opposite. Sexual immorality, impurity, debauchery, witchcraft, hatred, idolatry, discord, selfishness, and envy. And the world we live in is very much the opposite to what God intends us to live at. Thus, in the working environment, people will trample over others to get that position. It's not about putting people first, it's about putting yourself first and the world around us. And I don't know if you've seen any of those movies where there's a car chase scene, and all of a sudden the car is on the wrong side of the road, going against the flow of the traffic, trying to miss all the other cars coming towards them. And, you know, that's what it's like following Jesus, because we are living a life against the flow of this world. The powerful thing in this world would be to take. The powerful thing in God's kingdom is to give. And I'll tell you what, when you live in this way, in the world around us, you will be salt in that world around you. And when you put salt in a wound, what happens? It irritates. You will irritate people because of who you are, because you're living this powerful way of living. So some people will be irritated. Some people will be attracted by the way you are as well, and will ask, what is this about this person? And it's Jesus. It is Jesus. It is Jesus. Now, if we turn to John chapter 15, you see, it's very well talking about this, but we're talking about the unachievable. We cannot possibly live this way. And it's true, we can't live this way. But if we remain in Jesus, we can live this way. It's where our foundation is. It's where our roots are at. Because if you want to take this ground for God, this is the lifestyle we need to live. A lifestyle of humbleness. And it's not weak. That's what real man's about. Being humble. Putting others first. Showing love. That's what real strength's about. John 15 says this. I am the true vine, and my Father is the gardener. He cuts off every branch in me that bears no fruit. Well, every branch that does bear fruit, he prunes, so it will be even more fruitful. You are already clean because of the word I have spoken to you. Remain in me, and I will remain in you. No branch can bear fruit by itself. It must remain in the vine. Neither can you bear fruit unless you remain in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. If a man remains in me and I in him, he will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing. If anyone does not remain in me, he is like a branch that is thrown away and withers. Such branches are picked up, thrown into the fire and burned. If you remain in me and my words remain in you, ask whatever you wish and it be given you. This is my Father's glory, that you bear much fruit, showing yourselves to be my disciples. And here Jesus is using an illustration of being the true vine. And there's illustrations in the Old Testament of Israel being the vine, in which Israel was planted in the most perfect spot where it would be fed and watered and looked after. But Israel continually bear bad fruit. And Jesus is saying, I am the true vine. If you remain in me, you will bear fruit. And to me, that fruit can be described in two ways. One is the fruits of the Spirit, those characteristics coming out. And also the fruit of other people coming to faith as well. But you think about it, we cannot live this life for Jesus unless we remain in him. And as we remain in him, we become part of him. As we're part of him, he comes within us and directs us and puts us in the places he wants us to be. When many of you and I first got married, someone bought us a ficus benjamina. Basically, it's a little tree with leaves on it. But that is the real name for it, apparently. Look on the label. And I took a cutting of that tree 20-odd years ago and planted it in a small pot. And it's still alive today. But what I need to do with this tree, I bonsai'd it. I've got to cut pieces off it for it to grow and develop as a tree. I haven't done it much recently, so it looks a bit of a mess. But the thing about it is, sometimes there is dead wood on there. When I cut that dead wood back, new growth comes out and it bushes up. It looks good. If you ever come around, I'll show it to you. And one of the things Jesus mentions here is this. If you are bearing fruit, I will still prune you back, so you'll be even more fruitful. And that's saying to me various things. You know, we could be doing things today, which is bearing fruit today, but tomorrow it could be a new direction. And we need to be available to God, allowing him to make necessary adjustments to us as a body of people that we can grow. And we can look back to the last X amount of years to how we've changed things in this church for us to grow and develop. And for us to grow and develop further on down the line, we need to make changes today for that as well. And change to a body means changes to individuals as well, of what you're doing today. It may be a change in lifestyle, maybe a change in what you're actually doing. But we need to be open to change. And where there's change, there could be pain. Because we don't like change. We like being comfortable, we like sitting down what we're doing and keeping doing the same thing all the time. But to achieve what God wants us to do, we do need change. But the important thing is, in remaining in Jesus, we're able to take the change on because he gives us the ability to do this. Now, I've got a phone here. and it's got sat nav on it. And Wendy and I went to London the other day, a part of London I wasn't too familiar with, and the sat nav was great. But on the way back, it cut off. Rubbish. Absolutely rubbish. So I'm driving along in London, and Wendy's saying, "You turn left there." He goes, "No, look, it's saying go over there." "No, you turn left there." "No, you go over there." We had a bit of a disagreement in the car. Wendy, it's not about... I'm talking about humility here, aren't I? All right? Okay. Go home. Right, okay, now. She was right. Right, Wendy was right. So the sat-nav cut off. It took me, I ended up being 5 miles out of the way in London. Don't get one of these sat-navs for the phone. I lost connection. I got lost. But fortunately, next to me, there was someone who knew the way. Heather. No, that's my daughter, by the way. No. Wendy found out where we were, and we got there. And just as we got home, the sat-nav started working. All right. Now, the reason why I'm sharing that is this. For us to have, you know, the greatest potential in life, for us to achieve what we need to achieve for God, we need to remain in Jesus. We need to be part of his vine. We need to be obedient to what he's saying to us. And so often we go our own way and do our own thing. But as long as we're in tune with what he's doing, as long as they're walking where he's walking, we will achieve all sorts of things. Nothing is impossible for him. Everything is possible through him. And it's having that in mind. We cannot live a life of humility. We cannot live this meek way of living on our own strength. But through him, we can do this. We can achieve this. He gives us the ability. He gives us the ways. He gives us the strength. He gives us the words. He gives us the action to live that way. And the thing about Jesus, he's never turned himself off. He's always on and always available. The issue is, we wander off. We're the ones who turn off. Stay connected. Stay focused. Pray. Talk to him. Listen to him. Be obedient to him. You see, from this same passage, there's something quite amazing here. It says this in verse 7. I don't want to go in great detail in here, but it says this: if you remain in me and my words remain in you, ask whatever you wish and it'll be given you. So if you want a powerful prayer life, brothers and sisters, what do you need to do? Remain in Jesus. Because the type of prayers you'll be asking will be prayers which Jesus will be praying. Because we'll be praying with the heart and passion of Jesus. And you will change situations around you. You will see people saved. You will see people healed. You will see finances come where it wasn't before. Not because you wanted those things, but because God knows you needed those things at that time. And it comes down to an attitude of a heart change, of remaining in Jesus. And that's humble in itself, because you're not relying on yourself anymore, you're relying on God, aren't you? And humility starts with us realising that we cannot do the things in this earth in our own strength. We need to do it through the power of God, through Jesus Christ. Amen. If we go back to that Philippians passage, it says this. Verses 5 to 11. And to me, this is the greatest example of humility. It's page 1179, if you've lost your page. Your attitude should be the same as that of Christ Jesus. Remember who Jesus is. Who, being in the very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be grasped, but made himself nothing, taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness, and being found in appearance as a man. He humbled himself and became obedient to death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above all, above every name. At the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth. And every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. And to me, this reflects what it says on the screen here. He didn't love in order to get something from us, but to give everything of himself to us. And that is a demonstration to me of humility. He is the person who put this world together, who created this world, who created each one of you in this room. But yet, he was willing to come down in this earth in human likeness, that we can have a relationship with him. Isn't that a powerful, powerful message to the world around us? That is power. That is God's power. And for us to achieve the things God wants us to do, it means maybe a change of attitude. Because one of the questions you may need to ask yourself is, how can I live this way tomorrow when I'm in that workplace, when I'm in that school, when I'm in that home I live in? How can I do that? We can do it through the power of Jesus, but are you willing to serve him and to be there for him? On Thursday, I was doing some consultancy. I was there to hopefully win a contract for some work I do. And I went in this company, and it was a company which was an employment agency. So I take people on, and then sell those people's services off to people. And I was there for about 3 or 4 hours. And after about half an hour, I thought it'd be good to tell them what else I do, apart from consultancy. And I said to them, you know, this is a very small part of my life, but it's a good big part of my life, but an important part of my life. But the most important part of my life is what I do the rest of the week. And I explained what that was. And that I worked in a local church in which I was used to tell people about Jesus. 2 hours later, because that's how long that conversation went on for, she started telling me about people in the office who go to church. So we got them in together. We started talking about what we could do together. And they're starting a prayer morning this week at that place now. I said, I don't care about the contract. That's important if I win that. But the most important thing is, if I leave here today and you guys have found a closer relationship with God, that's far more important than winning that contract. And, you know, that is, to me, I mean, that's just an opportunity I had that week, that day. But it's realising that you're placed in these positions. to be there for Jesus. You're there for the work, but you're there to demonstrate and show them the love and the power of God, and for them to either accept it or reject it. Because at the end of the day, it's between them and God what they do with what you say and what you do amongst them. But it's important that you play your part in that role. And some of you here may be thinking, I've been going to this workplace for X amount of time, that's doing the work. It's time to change. It's time to go there to do God's work, which encompasses the work you're doing there as well. And I honestly believe that for us to see more growth in this church, it comes down to individuals playing a part for the body of Christ. If you're not playing your part, who else will do it for you? Because you've been placed there. You've been placed there by God. And you know, the great thing about the God we serve, he's entrusted us with these people, with these jobs, that you can make a difference there. That you can turn situations around there. Not by what you do, but through what God does through you. Do you want that? Do you want that? Amen. Amen. And, you know, an attitude of humility is difficult when things are up against you. But when we remain in Jesus, when we remain in Jesus, it's possible and achievable and a lot more. The question you need to be asking yourself is, how can I serve God when I leave this building? Who can I serve God for when I leave this building? Because I've said this time and time again, being amongst brothers and sisters, it's okay, it's a bit easier. But being out there, where it counts as well, because that's where you're meant to be, we invest so much time in 2 hours on a Sunday that we realise the time we need to invest in is the rest of the week, where we can come together here and say, God's done this, God's done that, God's been here, God's done all these things amongst us. Because we were willing to allow God to be the centre of what we're doing. Amen. Let's stand, shall we? I just want you to think about what has been said, and I want you to think about your own personal situations. Let's be still in God's presence for a few moments, and I'm going to pray. Each one of you have been placed in positions of authority for the God's kingdom. Every one of you in this room, you've been placed there by God. You've been put there by God. You've been chosen by God. And it's time to be that mouthpiece. It's time to be that person of God, that body, the hands, the feet of God, to make a difference there. Is there one person God wants you to speak to, or is there many people God wants you to speak to in the places he's put you into? Is there a change in your life you need to make? Do you know Jesus personally? Are you actually remaining in Jesus' moment in time? Let's pray, shall we? Father God, I just pray for your Spirit just to touch these people now, just to fill them now with your Spirit, that they are equipped, they are ready, they are available, they are there for you. Thus pour your Spirit upon them now, Jesus, and touch them and fill them and anoint them. People who've been in workplaces for a long time, create new opportunities. People who are starting new roles, show them what you want them to do there, Father. You've placed them there for a reason, Father. Just touch your body, touch your people, and make a difference, Father. To the world around us.
We do hope you've enjoyed and benefited from this presentation. To learn more about what the Bible teaches us and how to apply this to our everyday lives, check out our biblical teaching and other videos at gbcweb.tv.